guys, what's up? I just finished watching the Elseworlds crossover from the CW shows, and my mind is just all over the place. Let's just start, naturally, at the beginning. The Flash episode. First of all, let me just say, clearly the best episode out of the three. And I mean that in the best possible way. To start off the promo that we've seen in some of the episodes up to this point, with the Monitor arriving on Earth 90 and the 90s Flash and blah, 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 blah. And then you're dropped right into the action. Oliver Queen and Barry Allen have switched bodies, and now each character from each individual show believes that Oliver is Barry and Barry is Oliver, and wacky shenanigans ensues. Now, obviously, switching bodies in Freaky Fridays is nothing new in the world of comic book movies or comic book TV shows, but I believe that's the first time we've seen it in the CW universe, so yeah. What do I think about that? Perfect! Brilliant! It's done in a fantastic way that you believe that the characters that were unchanged feel and believe that these two characters have been these two people their entire lives, while at the same time you believe that the altered characters think and believe in each other's stories. And then there's the solution of how do you solve this body switching meta crisis? Well, bring in someone from another universe that hasn't been altered, Supergirl. And I believe that's a very clever thing that you can do now, because it's always sort of bothered me that when it comes to these CW crossovers, they always have to find some excuse to loop Supergirl into the mix, because Supergirl originally started on a different network, and now every time they do these crossovers, whether it's with the Legends as well, they sort of have to make an excuse as to why Supergirl has to cross from her universe to this universe to be there. But this excuse, this time around, was perfect. It was very well done. And the fact that they actually brought in Superman into this thing is just icing on the cake. First of all, let's just talk about the Superman thing as a whole. I really don't believe that there was any justification as to why Superman actually needed to be in this crossover. I guess they just wanted to throw Superman into the mix, and they said, well, you've got Tyler Hoechlin. He did a mostly good job in Supergirl Season 2, even though we kind of botched him in the last episode and we needed some excuse to do some damage control with that character. Well, let's put Superman into the story. And the Superman character actually came back in a very big way on the last episode, which we'll get to in a minute. But Amazo! We finally get to see the Amazo in the CW universe. Not the ship from Arrow Season 2. That's not the real Amazo. The actual Amazo, the android that mimics people's powers. I gotta tell you, as a kid growing up, watching the Justice League animated series, and watching the Amazo just wreck shop and destroying every single person in the Justice League, to see the actual Amazo in live action was a dream come true. It was amazing, like the Amazo. So yeah, I just absolutely loved seeing the Amazo. I think the Amazo was done perfectly, from the effects to how they maneuvered around his powers to how it was very crucially important that he would not copy Superman or Supergirl's powers for his own gain. I think the Amazo was one of the best handled parts of this CW crossover. Then we move on to the second episode of this crossover, the Arrow episode. This is where things kind of took a little step down for me. It's not what I would say the worst out of the three, but it's, not as good as The Flash. The Flash this season has been a much, much needed improvement over the previous season, which was just awful. But I do believe that Arrow has been the second best show this season, right after Legends of Tomorrow, which we unfortunately didn't really get to see all that much in this crossover episode. But I really enjoyed the way how they looped John Wesley Shipp's Flash from the 90s into the story. Unfortunately, I hoped we would have gotten to see him a lot more, other than just those 5 minutes at the end where he just showed up to just get poofed, and basically everything in the marketing that showed us those four people standing up to someone that we didn't know who. Yeah, that was kind of a disappointment, but that is not the main thing about this episode. The main thing about the second Elseworlds episode is Gotham. We finally got to see Gotham in its entirety on the CW universe. I mean, we've gotten hints and references to Bruce Wayne and this stuff from other shows, but we finally get to see Gotham in full force. And I gotta be honest, when Oliver, Barry, and Kara were released from prison and someone was there to pick them up, I was half expecting it to be Penguin. Really, I just really wanted to see Penguin and how Penguin looks in this CW universe, especially since we've gotten hints that possibly Edward Nygma is in this universe, and Pamela Isley, Poison Ivy, is in this universe. And I kind of enjoy the fact that he made Mark Guggenheim one of the people who works at Arkham. That I kind of enjoyed that little bit of meta Easter egg. But all the same, I think we all realize what the main point of the Gotham element of this episode was meant to represent, and it wasn't to set up Batman. I'll admit, I was half expecting Batman, or at the very least Bruce Wayne, to make an appearance in this episode, but this episode wasn't about Batman. It was about Batwoman, and we've already known that for a while, ever since Stephen Amell kind of offhand mentioned that next year's crossover, we're gonna have Batwoman there, and we're gonna go to Gotham City, and blah blah blah, and I was like, what? So, I was kind of disappointed that they went with Batwoman and not Batman, especially because of all this weird nonsense DC rules where Batman and Superman are reserved for the movies and they can't cross the movie characters with the TV show characters, and a lot of confusion. That's one of the main reasons why they had to find some excuse to write Deathstroke out of the show, because they were planning to put him in the movies. But now that's gone out the window. No idea what's going on with Deathstroke. Speaking of Deathstroke, we get to see his son back. So yeah, that's something. Maybe Deathstroke Jr. is going to be a major player in the Arrow TV show going forward, since they can't use Manu Bennett's Slade Wilson. I don't know. I'm just confusing myself trying to make sense of all this nonsense. Regardless, the Arkham sequence, I believe, was handled perfectly. There was so many damn Easter eggs in that one sequence. I don't think any one fan could just name them all. From the Bane mask to the streets named Nolan Burton. We get teased that Victor Freeze exists in this universe, but didn't really get to see him. We only saw his ice gun. Regardless, the way they used Victor Freeze, Mr. Freeze's freeze gun on Killer Frost, that was a nice, interesting thing that I actually really enjoyed. But let's just talk about Ruby Rose herself, Kate Kane, the Batwoman. I gotta be honest, guys, I didn't think we'd get to see enough of Batwoman to truly evaluate whether Ruby Rose deserves a show on her own. And really, that was kind of mentioned when they first came up with the idea of having Batwoman in this crossover. It was supposed to be a setup for a potential Batwoman show, which I'm very much interested to see. I think Ruby Rose did her part to perfection, both as Kate Kane and as Batwoman, but again, we didn't get to see enough of Batwoman in this one episode to truly see whether or not she deserves a series of her own. If they do end up giving her own series, I'd be very much for it. I love what she did in this crossover. I would very much like to see her again. pleased. But as far as this sample size, I don't think it's a big enough of a sample size to evaluate whether or not she deserves to have her own show. And now let's talk about what I think was the least good episode of this crossover, the Supergirl episode. I have some issues with it. It was a very well done episode in general. I just have some personal issues regarding Superman and how Superman was handled during this episode. First of all, the main villain of this piece, John Deegan, Dr. John Deegan, somehow decided to change himself into Superman, which, hey, I thought it was a very good idea. If you're gonna make yourself the hero, why not make yourself the biggest hero of all time? Superman! In any universe you go to, Superman is Superman. And the fact that he actually made himself the evil Superman, and now all the heroes from the main universe have to fight an evil Superman, I felt like echoes of Injustice Gods Among Us written all over this episode, and I loved it. Whether you played the game, or read the comics, or did both, which is exactly what I did, but evil Superman is one of the best things in DC Comics history. When it's written well, when it's written by the guys from the Injustice Gods Among Us series, evil Superman is one of the best Supermen you're ever going to get. Unfortunately, it's not technically evil Superman, since it's some douche pretending to be Superman, but that's neither here nor there. It still kind of felt evil Superman-ish, but yeah, the fact that Superman, the real Superman, was brought in to fight him, since the only one who can beat evil Superman is proper Superman, I loved it, but he didn't really get to do much. I enjoyed the fact that evil Superman threw a chopper full of people and good Superman was trying to save them, but after that, I think good Superman was kind of taken out like a bitch, and that's something that a lot of people, myself included, have had multiple problems with during the end of Supergirl Season 2. A lot of people think that Superman was made into a joke, that they made Superman into a jobber, and no matter how much I pushed back against that idea, it's kind of hard to ignore it now, especially since the episode basically ended with Superman and Lois Lane no longer on Earth 38, and now Supergirl is the only super person defending the Earth. Yeah, it's a very good new direction for Supergirl, the show, especially since she left the DEO and now she's got her whole new destiny. But yeah, that was kind of disappointing. Regardless, the other heroes were portrayed beautifully in this episode, from Barry Allen doing his thing and Oliver Queen basically talking down to a god like the Monitor, because he's Oliver Queen and no one messes with Oliver Queen, except maybe Batman apparently. But even the intrusion of Brainiac 5 and Martian Manhunter, and even Lois Lane got to do some action in this episode. And once again, one of my favorite parts of the crossover, Amazo. Yeah, I think this entire episode could have been done better, but yeah, the entire crossover as a whole, I think it was handled with such a really good attention to both detail and both storytelling and fan service that really I can't offer too many complaints about this episode, except for maybe how Superman was handled at the end. But that's really the only criticism I might have on this whole crossover as a whole. And we gotta talk about the tease. Crisis on Infinite Earths. We've been waiting for so long for this. I can't wait to see what they come up with in next year's crossover. Even the fact that they referenced that, oh, this is becoming an annual thing now. We're meeting every year to do some crossover shenanigans. Yeah, I still think that Crisis on Earth X was the best crossover in the CW universe, and I was really, really hoping Elseworlds will become bigger and better than it would end up being. But again, I enjoyed the episode a lot. I was screaming like a little kid at every little detail, even the fact that they somehow managed to find a way to loop Gary into this crossover. Yeah, I really enjoyed that. I love this crossover episode. Can't wait to see what they come up with next time on Crisis on Infinite... Sorry. I need to get this right. Crisis on Infinite Earths. Yeah. It's coming, guys. Yeah. Crisis on Infinite Earths. Yeah, let's go. I wonder what's gonna happen next. Are they gonna completely rewrite the entire CW universe and restart over? Maybe we'll finally get to see some of the movie characters, like, you know, Shazam, or Aquaman, or Wonder Woman, or perhaps maybe Batman, since we now know Batman exists in this universe, and they actually referenced him by name. I think that was really good food for thought for the potential Batwoman series, that, oh yeah, Batman has been around for a while, but now he's gone, now Batwoman is taking charge. I think it there was a bit of a missed opportunity that they didn't cross over this enough with the Gotham TV series. I would have really liked to see Ben McKenzie as Commissioner Gordon in this one episode. Maybe Donald Lowe as Harvey Bullock. But yeah, I'm just satisfied with what I got. And really, that's all I can say about this. So I really enjoyed this episode. I hope you guys enjoyed it too. And until next time, I'm not going to rip my shirt, but I'll pop it away!
Hello again, everybody. I hope you liked this video, and if you did, please remember to like, share, and subscribe to my channel, where I do all kinds of weird stuff, like showcase all these things, you know, trailer reactions, movie reviews, all kinds of fun stuff. So, until next time, I'll see you guys next time.